This video is on journalizing using a perpetual inventory system. Please pause the video and make sure you have a piece of paper so that we may record the journal entries together on the books of the purchaser and the seller. Okay, let's read the directions. Journalize the following transactions on the book of the purchaser and seller, assuming they both use a perpetual inventory system. On October 2nd, Costco Inc. sold merchandise to MSK Inc. for $470. Terms to 10 in 30. FOB destination. Inventory sold costs Costco $200. So what we're going to do is determine who is the purchaser and who is the seller. Now, if Costco sold merchandise to MSK, MSK Inc. would be the purchaser and Costco would be the seller. So let's go ahead and set up your paper accordingly. And I'm going to go ahead and move this down a little bit so we can see. Alrighty, so on the purchaser's books, we're going to go ahead and put the date. It's October 2nd. In the accounts we're going to use, we're going to do a debit to inventory and the amount of the purchase, $470. And of course, we got a credit in account, and we will credit, let's see, accounts payable. And how we know it's accounts payable and not cash is because we're given terms to 10 and 30. Those terms were discussed in the chapter, and that basically means a 2% discount if paid within 10 days. If not, then the net amount, whatever amount we have left that we owe the our vendor, we need to pay it in full by 30 days from the date of purchase, which was October 2nd. So this is what the journal entry would look like on the purchaser's books. Debit to inventory, credit to accounts payable, $470. And 470. Now the next thing is we're going to skip a space and read the information for the second transaction. Okay, appropriate party paid shipping costs of $30 to UPS to ship inventory to purchaser. So appropriate party paid, so that would be for October 2nd. And the shipping terms are FOB destination. As discussed in your textbook, FOB stands for free on board destination. So what that means is it is the responsibility of the seller until it gets to the final destination, which is the receiving docks of the purchaser's location. So in that case, the seller would be responsible for paying the shipping charges. So on the purchaser's books, there would be no entry. Now, if the terms were in fact FOB shipping point, then if those were the terms, then you would actually have a journal entry and the purchaser would actually be responsible for paying the shipping charges. And if that were the case, you would debit inventory for the costs and you'd go ahead and pass that along to the cost of the inventory, and then you would credit cash for the amount paid to UPS for whatever amount it ends up being. But that's only if it's FOB shipping point. Now, since it's not, let's go ahead and erase that and return it back to no entry. And reason being is FOB destination. Or you can simply leave it blank since there's no journal entry. Okay, the next one. Let's see what we have for the next one. On October 4th, we have MS Inc. returned $70 in inventory to Costco. Now, that's one thing I like about Costco. They allow returns. So here we are, we're returning something, 70 bucks, and the inventory was not defective, and Costco will resell it to another customer. Costco's original cost for the return merchandise was $50. So using that information and preparing the proper journal entry, we're going to go with October 4th. And because it's a return, we are going to decrease our accounts payable. And that would be what? How much did it cost us? The return was $70. And we will credit our inventory. Since we are returning it, we no longer have it in inventory. So this would be the entry we would put down in the purchaser's books. Okay, our next entry will be October 12th. And on this date, October 12th, MSK Inc. took advantage of the discount and remitted the amount owed to Costco. So keep in mind, we acquired this inventory on the 2nd, and we are paying in full the amount that we owe. Well, because the 12th is 10 days from the date of the invoice, we're entitled to the discount. So even though we're looking at the balance that we owe in accounts payable. Now, how much is our current balance on this date? Well, if we bought it $470 on account on the 2nd, turned around and did a return, we're looking at $400 is what we owe. So 470 minus the 70. And then when we look at the amount that we're actually going to pay, so we're going to credit cash. This will be our payment in cash. It will be the amount that we owe minus 2%. So if you were to take 98% times the 400, we're actually paying out 392. And that difference of 8, which is 2%, of transfers translates into multiplication times the 400. That's where we get the $8. That represents the discount, and that discount is going to be a reduction in our cost of inventory. So this is what it's going to look like. So we're basically just taking the 470 minus the 70, subtract 2% of the 400 to give us a 392. And that's what we would do in terms of the purchaser's books. Okay, so now we're ready to do the journal entries on the seller's books. So we're going to use that same information that we used earlier. So going back to October 2nd, the day that Costco made the sale. Now, on Costco's books, when they make the sale, it's going to be on account as well, because don't forget the term. We have accounts receivable. So accounts receivable, and we're charging our customer $470, and that would be a sale to us. So we're going to use sales revenues. You can also use just sales, depends on the chart of account for the company. Now that's only part of the journal entry. That's under the revenue recognition principle, because title is transferring. We want to go ahead and recognize the sale at that point in time. And actually, officially, it would be when they actually received it, because the terms are what? FOB destination, title transfers. And we also want to recognize the expense that relates to this 470. So if we look here, it says inventory sold costs Costco $200. So that means that our cost of goods sold is going to be $200. And $200 is coming out of our inventory, since that was our inventory cost of the items that are being sold. So both of these entries will be done on October 2nd. Then we go down to the 2nd, appropriate party paid shipping costs of $30, because the terms are FOB destination. It'll look like this on the seller's books. They're making the payment 10-2. And we will charge it to the expense account, freight out, freight out because we are the seller and this is a cost to get it out. It is a selling expense, and that was $30. And since we paid it, they use the words paid, we can assume we credit cash. And again, there's no entry on the books of the buyers because the seller is taking care of it based on the current terms. Now the next date, we have 10-4, was a return. And this return, we're going to put it back into inventory because it's not defective. Let's read the item again. MSK Inc. returned $70 in inventory to Costco. The inventory was not defective, and Costco will resell it to another customer. So Costco's original cost for this $70 in return merchandise was $50. So we're going to have to do two journal entries similar to what we did up here. And again, we're doing this because we're using a perpetual inventory system. So we will debit sales, returns, and allowances. And this is a contra revenue account. Normal balance is debit. It offsets sales. And we'll go ahead and put the 70 here and 70 here. And we will credit accounts receivables. Now, some of you may ask, well, why not debit sales? Well, a lot of companies like to keep track of their sales returns in a separate account so they can kind of but do better planning in the future and identify if there's an issue with their inventory that they're selling to their customers. So we're going to do the second part. This also will occur exactly at the same time, so it's going to be the same date. And we're going to put it back in the inventory because it's not defective. And we'll go ahead and look at our original cost for these items, which was $50. And so this inventory right here, we're going to go ahead and credit cost of goods sold. And I'm going to use COGS, COGS for short. And we'll put it back into our inventory. Now, just a side note, if we were allowing them to keep the inventory and we were, let's say, just giving them an allowance, then there would be no need for the second entry. In addition, if it's defective, then you would have to figure out the actual value and then write it down and use a lesser amount if it's a smaller scrap value. Or if it's no good, then you wouldn't even do any journal entry recordings. So the next thing we have, let's see, is on the 12th. And again, MSK took advantage of the discount and remitted the amount owed to Costco. Now we already did the calculations earlier over here, so you see that it has the 392. So your assumption over here on the 12th, they receive the cash in the amount of 392. The difference of 8 is going to go to another contra revenue account, which is sales discount, and then we have the total of these two, settling the full account that's are expected to be received, so accounts receivable, and that amount is 400. And that is how you do the journal entries for a purchaser or a seller under a perpetual inventory system. Any questions on the solution, please post your questions and the discussion forum.